you get addicted to it, then there's a lot of work that you have to do. But you can do it, but you have to first understand what it's going to take in order to, for me to quit tobacco use.
Gotcha.
Well, actually, and that's the question for you, because I know that there are quite a few, there's a lot of people out there who want to quit smoking. They know it's bad for your health. You see the commercials. But, you know, to my understanding, you know, this is craving, and this is craving that is basically unbearable. And we're probably going to talk about this more in the show, but how do you overcome such a
urge
or such a craving?
Well, there's several ways. Okay, there are several ways, and that's why I said the first step is understanding what you're dealing with.
Gotcha.
Okay, you got to understand, you know, what I'm dealing with, and this is a substance that you've put in your body for X amount of years. Okay, that now your body has now become dependent upon it. Okay, if you never ate chicken, you don't know what the taste of chicken is.
Gotcha.
Okay, and you're not going to crave chicken.
Gotcha.
You might see it and might desire to want to taste it, but you don't have a craving for it because there's nothing that introduced into yourself to say this is the taste of chicken. So, but once you introduce yourself to tobacco use, then you will crave it because it's highly addictive, because what's in it is causing you to be addicted, which is there is 4,000 chemicals in every cigarette that you smoke. So you got to understand that there's 20 cigarettes in a pack of cigarettes, and each cigarette contains 4,000 chemicals. So if you multiply 4,000 chemicals times 20, that's a whole lot of chemicals, like rat poisoning and vomit fluid. I mean, you got a lithia of these substances. So that being in mind, if you have done this over and over and over again, and we are creatures of habit, once we do something, our body gets dependent upon it.
True.
Then we want it. Okay. So, you know, when that happens, then you have to decide if this is something that you want to do. Is this something that I really want to, you know, to stop doing? You know, do I want to really deal with these cravings? Because I can deal with these cravings, and there's many things that I can do to help with the cravings. But again, the second thing I would say was that you have to assess your readiness to quit. Because as they say, you can bring a horse to the water, but you can't make him drink.
Yes.
So you're going to have to want to quit the tobacco use and want to deal with what I would call, as we outlined in the show, the things that you can do to help with the cravings. Okay, but you got to want to know, you have to know that you know that you know that you know that this is something that I'm ready to launch into.
That's what's up.
And I want to count the cost. Gotcha. I want to count the cost. What is it going to take for me to eliminate and to reduce the cravings? For a while, even though we'll talk about the different medications and things you can take, but it will still take your work on your part. Gotcha. So that you can help combat or win the war against the trigger or these cravings that you have.
Gotcha. And the one thing I want to throw out there, and it could be a typo, because every week we get information from Valerie Wright, that's our producer.
Okay.
But on some information that she gave me, you have mentioned, and right now I'm using scare tactic.
Okay.
Because you mentioned 4,000, and this information I have right 5, there, it says there's 7,000 different chemicals in cigarettes, and out of those 7,000 different chemicals, 69 of them, which is a small amount, but still, 69 of them are known to cause cancer and directly responsible for lung cancer and death.
Well, the carcinogens,
yes.
Cancer-causing agents, okay,
gotcha.
And that's 46, but it is definitely 4,000.
Okay, thank you.
Okay,
it is 4,000. Thank you for clearing that up for me.
So that is a typo. But yeah,
still a lot.
Yeah.
It's still a lot.
Right. It's still a lot. That's a whole lot.
4,000 is a lot.
Yeah, that's enough.
That is enough.
To add 3,000 more.
Times 20 if you're smoking that pack, and if you're smoking that pack a day.
You know.
All right, ladies and gentlemen. We will be right back. We are going to take a short break. You're listening to Health in Harlem on WHCR 90.3 FM New York. You can call in with any comments, questions, or concerns at 212-650-6903. That's 212-650-6903. We will be right back. Stay with us.
WHCR 90.3 FM New York.
Backed by popular demand, after sold-out performances last season, the world-famous Apollo Theater presents an all-new staging of Ellington at Christmas Nutcracker Suite, featuring Broadway stars Norm Lewis and Priscilla Baskerville, with performances by Liz Wright, Jason Samuel Smith, students from the Dance Theater of Harlem, and more. Musical direction by David Berger. Performances are December 13th and December 14th for three performances only. You heard me, three performances only. Tickets are available at Ticketmaster.com or visit www.apollotheater.org for more information.
The Harlem Hospital Center Department of Food and Nutrition Services hosts its annual food drive on Monday, November the 10th through December the 24th. You can donate unexpired, non-perishable food products to any food bank receptacle located throughout Harlem Hospital. All food collected will be donated to Harlem Mothers Save. This is your opportunity to help provide food for families in need during the holiday season. Harlem Hospital is located at 506 Lenox Avenue at 135th Street. For more information, call Sean Shivers at 212-939-1936.
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
Welcome back to the one and only Health in Harlem. I'm Maurice Selby.
And this is Sean Shivers.
And tonight, ladies and gentlemen, we have Miss Eugenia Black Graham.
The professional in the house.
Assistant Director of Surgery Subspecialties at Harlem Hospital and also the Director of the Smoking Cessation Program at Harlem Hospital Center. And she is here to share her wisdom on smoking cessation, talking about the triggers, and also when we can start to establish a plan to get this done. And, you know, the cold turkey approach, as valiant and strong as one might seem, doesn't work for most people. So we are talking about ways to fight this war. As Ms. Graham said, this is a war, and wars are not fought blindly. You don't just go into battle with no strategy, right? You see generals get together at the table, they pull out those calipers and those compasses, and they start mapping things out and positioning their troops and resources to go to battle so that they can be as effective as possible. And that's what we need to happen with smoking cessation. So how, when an individual gets this concept in their head, they start to see that their nails are turning yellow, their breath isn't smelling good. These are all the effects of smoking.
Yes, that's
yellow
true.
Teeth. Right.
Yeah.
Maybe they're having trouble. For the gentlemen out there, performing with their spouse. Right.
Impulse,
all of these
yes.
issues. So now this individual gets this idea in their head. I think this might not be for me. Where do they go from there?
Well, first of all, sitting down with a counselor, you know, someone who does this every day, all day, professionals. And start what we call an assessment of a readiness to quit, you know, is really critical. You know, being honest with oneself, looking at the cost. I always say count the cost.
Mm-hmm.
What is it going to take for me to stop this addiction? Am I willing to do the things that I need to do in order for me to quit? So you got to look at, Maurice had mentioned, you know, the different modalities, and we meet people where they're at. And this is why we like to sit down and talk to people and assess their readiness to quit and then offer them the various modalities that they can use to quit. Because some people, such as myself, ex-cigar smoker, I did cold turkey. Mm. I had it made in my mind.
Cigars. Okay.
Cigars, you know, yeah, black and mild. You know, you know, the community cigars.
I feel you.
Right. You know, but for me, it was, I can't breathe. I'm an asthmatic. And it was just, you know, no-brainer. Genie, you can't smoke. You can't breathe, you know, and smoke at the same time. So I had to make a decision what I was going to do, so I do it at cold turkey.
Mm-hmm.
But when we sit down with our patients or people who want to quit smoking, we offer them, you know, the different modalities, harm reduction, cold turkey, pharmaceutical intervention, behavior modification. Those are some of the modalities that we use in terms of, you know, offering to people and just sitting down saying, here's what it's going to take. Let's outline a plan. This is what happens. This is what your body's going to go through, because as you begin to wean yourself off of tobacco, you are going to have those cravings. Mm. And here's what we can do to help combat those cravings. But are you willing to pick up the gum, quote, one of the pharmaceutical therapies for quit smoking and to deal with the craving, opposed to picking up that cigarette, that cigar, or chewing that tobacco? Mm.
Mm. Now, the question I want to throw out there to you is that, and this is what I'm hearing from a lot of individuals in the community, friends of mine, is that they've been advertising this electronic cigarette, and individuals are saying, well, I'm hearing that if you use the electronic cigarette opposed to just using a regular cigarette, it will help you slowly get off, but it's also better than the regular cigarette because you're bringing in less tobacco.
And less chemicals.
Can you clear this up? Is that true or not? Or basically your opinion on this?
Well, you know, here's my opinion on it, because I really haven't really studied it, you know, out. So let's just put that out there.
Your opinion.
So my opinion is that there are, with that electric cigarette, is there are toxins.
Yes.
That's there. And so that's not anything that we want to recommend. Because remember now, with the pharmaceutical agents that we give in place of your tobacco, is just that.
Mm-hmm.
We're not giving you any other toxins like the electronic cigarettes. We're just giving you the nicotine that you're addicted to. And then we're tapering you off.
Mm.
Okay? So not those 3,999 other chemicals opposed to the 6,000 that you thought was 7,000.
Yeah. I got you.
Okay. But so, you know, that's the difference. And then you're under supervision with professionals that know how to taper you off. I always tell patients or people who want to quit smoking, using the pharmaceuticals that we give, the gum, the inhaler, the nasal spray, the patches, it's like a methadone program.
Yes,
we give you right.
Mm-hmm.
We give you X amount, and then we begin to taper you down. Okay? So what you're addicted to is what we give you, but then we taper you down. Opposed to that electronic cigarette, which is toxin.
Mm.
Okay, they talking about taking in those vapors and stuff like that. And sometimes, I mean, and I do hear from people ask me all the time about, oh, you know, what about this electronic cigarette? I think I'll try that, but they still smoke.
I understand.
Okay, they still smoke. Mm. Not now. Sometimes people still smoke with the products as well.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And I'll give you my professional opinion. The study, there are not that many studies on these
cigarettes.
To conclude, to thoroughly say that these are safe. And right now, they might seem like a better alternative because as Ms. Graham and yourself, Sean, as you said, you're not exposed to 4,000 chemicals every time you take a breath of these things. And you know, they say that there's water vapor coming out of the cigarette, so therefore less secondhand smoke. However, it's not definitive yet, so don't hang your hat on that. And let's say you don't want to take one habit and substitute another, right? We're talking about...
That's an excellent point.
Yeah, we're talking about the economics as well. You know, just cut it out. Because, what, cigarettes, how much does a pack of cigarettes cost nowadays?
$25, $30.
And the electronic ones, and the electronic ones ain't no cheaper. So
You're right.
We're talking about, you know.
At least a $12, $13 for a pack of cigarettes.
Just cut it out.
Okay, right. And again, like I said, that, you know, that's our goal, too, when you deal with professionals and with a program. That's why I talked about tapering you off, because we don't want to make sure that you go from one addiction to another addiction.
Got you.
That's not the goal at all. The goal is to get you off of any form of tobacco, nicotine altogether.
Got you. Okay, and I got another question for you. This is talking about secondhand smoking, right? And the questions that I'm throwing at you right now are things that I hear in the community, friends and stuff. Secondhand smoke is as bad as smoking a cigarette.
It's worse.
Thank you. Clear that up now.
Okay.
Please.
So, and I'm glad because this comes up all the time.
Thank you.
Okay. Normally, when a person gets secondhand smoke, there is no filter. You just get the raw smoke. When you're smoking a cigarette, normally there's a little filter at that tip, right?
Mm-hmm.
That you know, kind of, you know, you get the chemicals and stuff like that, but you don't get it rawly.
Gotcha.
Okay, but when you're taking secondhand smoke, you get all those 4,000 chemicals rawly. There's no filter. You're just taking all those in. Okay, and that's why it's worse. And that's why it has become an environmental issue and why there's so many environmental programs, you know, out here trying to fight against the emissions of tobacco use in the ear, because people get cancers and anything else, like anybody else.
Asthma exacerbation.
Absolutely.
Yep. So basically,
secondhand
smoke is just like smoking a cigarette.
It's worse.
Thank you for clearing that up.
Absolutely. Okay. And this is why we try to get the family members as well. We encourage the family members to come along to the program with that tobacco user so that they can help as well, you know, in terms of quitting and motivating them and being a support to them, because they are just in danger as the person that who's actually using the form of that tobacco when it comes to a person who's actually smoking.
So my one question that I have, right, because I know individuals that tried to quit smoking. And we have a lot of individuals that I think really want this to happen. They understand that it's not good for them. It's not contributing anything to their pockets. It's not contributing anything to their families. So they wanna quit this. They wanna move on. And individuals try to quit. However, not everyone is successful. We know that. But what makes me nervous for these people is, you know, when you don't succeed at something, to come back and try again is that much harder. So how can we ensure or work to make sure that we're successful the first time through, so that an individual doesn't experience this setback where they have to, again, you know, regain momentum, regain the motivation to then try to quit again? Because I think that could be even harder the second time or third time or fourth time around, to the point where the person might even just give up.
Well, people do get discouraged. Mm-hmm. And that's why when people sit down and they talk to us and we're doing our assessment, sometimes I don't always recommend that a person quits at the stage in which they're in when we first meet. It depends on, based upon when we do, like I said, we have an actual formal assessment on paper that we do, and we go through everything with the patient. And depending on what they're going through right now, for example, if you are going through a divorce, you don't have a job,
stress,
you know, your family's acting up, the kids are crazy, everything is going wrong, that might not be a time for you to quit right now. Okay, you got too much things going
on.
Okay, and if you've been smoking for 40 years or 50 years, I mean, if you smoke for another month, I mean, you already got 50 years into the game. So, you know, that might not be a time for you to quit, because you got so many different stress factors, and you have to really deal now with stress management. So oftentimes, if a person's trying to deal with stress management because they're going through hell, and then they're trying to deal with triggers, that sometimes is overwhelming, and that's causing them to even smoke more. Okay? So people don't really think about that, but sometimes that is really not the time for you to quit smoking at that time.
Gotcha.
But if you're willing, now some people, like, I mean, I was ready, like I couldn't breathe. There are people that just said, I'm done, and they just cold turkey, they don't use nothing, and they're done. They made up in their mind that's what they wanted to do. But for people who are still sitting on the fence and still contemplating and wondering, you know, about, you know, I want to quit, but I still enjoy it, you know, they're like that ambivalence. So then you need to take some time, and we need to go through some steps with you to show, are you ready to make this commitment, and then take the steps that it takes in order for you to quit. Therefore, that way, Maurice, it won't be you stop and starting. You know that when you decide that you have set your quit date, you have probably begin to maybe even participate in what I call harm reduction. Maybe, depending on what modality we use for you, because we look at the total person. Maybe we say, okay, you smoke 20 cigarettes now. Let's just start you off smoking only 15 a day. So start have you reducing. So prepare you to quit. I mean, you know, we got the different stages. You know, we got pre-contemplation, we got contemplation, you know, we got preparation, we got readiness, maintenance, and then we got relapse. So that's what we do when we say assess you. We have formal tools that looks at what stage are you in. Because if you're on pre-contemplation stage, baby love, this is not,
it's not
right
your
now
game.
For you.
I hear you.
Okay,
yeah,
see, we want to, like, you know, we want to rush to quit. No. We're trying to make a lifestyle change. So let's get all the tools. Like I said, if you're in a war, we got to get the right arsenal. Mm-hmm. So you don't bring you don't bring a knife to a gunfight, baby love. If you got a gun, I got there something bigger than yours.
Yeah, I hear you.
So that's what I'm telling people. If you understand what we're into and what you need in order to win this war, because you can win it, but we're going to give you the right tools.
Got you. And that's like when you're trying to lose weight. You can't just say, okay, I'm going to stop eating. I'm just going to cut it. No, you have to gradually start decreasing your portion sizes and I'm sorry, the show's about smoking, but I got you.
No, but I think that's a relevant point. Because whatever it is, whether you're going back to school, whatever it is that you wanted, the goals that you're setting out, you have to be willing to do the work. Maurice is in school right now for medicine, right? Mm-hmm. Well, you know, Maurice has to turn off that cell phone.
True story.
You know what I'm trying to say? Mm-hmm. He had to turn off that TV. He had to hit those books. You can't hang out with the boys all the time.
True story.
You
see what I'm saying? As much as you want to, can't do it.
Right? Yeah. And same with smokers. Maybe what you have to do, if your trigger is alcohol, we got to leave alcohol alone. Maybe for a minute or two so we can get this under our belt.
Exactly.
If you hang out with other smokers, you might not have to hang out with them right now. Or like you said, tell people they come to your house. You when you want to smoke, go outside. You
see, these don't are all the type
of... That right did some great advice right there.
Set barriers.
Yeah, no, right. Exactly.
No.
So, ladies and gentlemen, you are listening to Health in Harlem on WHCR 90.3 FM New York. I have a bit of a trick question for you all out there, and the individual that can answer this question, both post it on our Facebook page, Health in Harlem. You type in the search box, Health in Harlem, you'll see two handsome gentlemen pop up, Sean
sexy
and myself.
Men. Yep.
Sexy men. Mm-hmm. And
absolutely,
you can leave...
I can attest to that.
Thank you very much. You can leave your comment, your answer there. But the question is, what is the leading cause of disability in the United States? You leave your answer on our page and also... try to call in with your answer. The first person to get it right will receive a gift card, a Macy's gift card.
I was going to say a prize of a speakable value, but you threw it out. You said a Macy's card.
Oh, wow.
Yes. Macy's gift card, $50, which is, I think, much needed during this holiday season. So leave your answer on our page and then call in to the studio and we will honor you. Okay?
Wonderful.
We'll be right back after this break, ladies and gentlemen. Remember, also, you can call in at 212-650-6903. That's 212-650-6903. You're listening to Health in Harlem. We will be right back. Stay with us.
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
If you know the symptoms and get the facts, you'll know the signs of a heart attack. Women, listen to me, and when I'm done, if it sounds familiar, call 911.
Pain in your neck, chest,
arms, or jaw,
shortness of breath,
please tell us more. Cold sweats and nausea, tiredness,
it's time to take it serious.
Back pain, stomach pain, shortness of breath, cold sweats, nausea, dizziness. If you know the symptoms and heed the signs, you'll be around for a long, long time. Women, listen to me, and when I'm done, if any sound familiar, call 911.
Learn a song that could save your life. Get a free download at womenshealth.gov/heartattack.
Women, listen to me, and when I'm done, if any sound familiar, call 911. If any sound familiar, call 911.
A message from the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services.
911. Hey, this is Donna, and I want to personally invite you to my restaurant, Home Sweet Harlem. Home Sweet Harlem is a lovely American bistro located at 1528 Amsterdam Avenue between 135th and 136th Streets. You can join us for a good cup of coffee, breakfast, lunch, and dinner. Our menu includes heart-healthy foods like a variety of fresh mixed salad greens, grilled garlic shrimp, smoothies, and fresh juices, the amazing St. Nicholas Park turkey burger, and the grilled marinated chicken kebabs are among our most popular dishes. Our weekend brunches include a delicious farmer's skillet, which is a baked omelet, and it's baked in a cast iron skillet and served with homemade biscuits. We also offer an affordable meeting space for community groups, art shows, and live music. That's Home Sweet Harlem, located at 1528 Amsterdam Avenue between 135th and 136th Streets. You can reach us at 212-926-9616.
Hi, I'm Vinny B of the Vinny B Showcase. Tune in every Thursday from 8 to 12 midnight for some solid cultural roots music and some sweet lovers rock. Also, informative interviews and giveaways. Right here on the Vinny B Showcase every Thursday, 8 through 12 midnight on WHCR, 90.3 FM. Peace. I'm tougher than rock. Said I'm
black. I'm tougher than rock. WHCR, 90.3 FM, New York.
Yes, indeed, ladies and gentlemen, it is time for healing. I'm Maurice Selby.
And this is Sean Shivers.
And tonight we have with us from Harlem Hospital, Mrs. Eugenia Black Graham. She is the Assistant Director of Surgery Subspecialties at Harlem Hospital and a Director of the Smoking Cessation Program at Harlem Hospital Center as well. And we are talking about smoking cessation tonight. Very heavy conversation up to this point. But before we get back to that, Sean has an announcement to make.
Oh, yeah. I forgot about it. It's all good. The announcement, again, is that this is the season and this is the time that you need to go into your kitchen and go into your pantries and look at all those canned goods that you have that have been sitting there for the past 8, 9, couple of months and bring them all to Harlem Hospital. We're having our annual food drive, and we have receptacles set up in all of our buildings at Harlem Hospital Center, inside the Merrill Pavilion, the new addition to the hospital, MLK Building, WP Building, Kuntz Building. I know I'm throwing a lot of buildings at you, but any building that you walk inside, you'll see a receptacle there. Take all your canned goods, bring them in. If you are unable to bring your canned goods, I will send somebody out to pick them up. So if you call me at 212-939-1936, again, it's 212-939-1936, I will send somebody out and pick those up from you. And also just to mention, all donations are going to Harlem's Mother Save. Stop Violence. Am I saying it right? Harlem Mother Saves. That is Stop Another Violent End. So outside of taking guns off the streets, they're also providing food to the families in need in our community. So please assist us in completing this food drive. And we're going to be doing this up until Christmas Eve, the 24th. So bring all your canned goods in. You know, we'll take them.
Is it tax deductible, Sean?
I don't have any of those forms, but you know, that's a thought. That's a thought. I'm not going to say yes now, but I'm going to say, you know, that's something to think about for next year.
Yeah, well, or come back with it next week and let the public know.
Correct. Mm-hmm. That's a thought. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Great question.
Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, remember we have a little trivia going on tonight. What is the leading cause of disability in the United States? Whoever answers this, both on our webpage and calls in to answer, calls into WHCR to answer the question, they will receive a Macy's gift card of $50 value. So just in time for the holidays. That's good to me. I'll take that any day.
Absolutely.
Take that.
Getting back to our conversation, ladies and gentlemen. So Ms. Graham, when we talked about, you know, getting the gusto, getting everything together, the motivation, getting your strategy together to go about and be successful in quitting smoking. Now, what are some of the resources and services available at Harlem Hospital, and even if you can, throughout HHC, the Health and Hospitals Corporation, what are some of the resources available to individuals to give them that support, the ammunition, the troops, the resources, the human resources that people need to accomplish this goal?
Well, I'm proud to say that Harlem Hospital Center Quit Smoking Program is still one of the only hospitals that still have support groups.
Excellent.
So, you know, we're just the only one. And so many people, Presbyterian, St. Luke's, and other HHC hospital send their patients to us.
Mm.
Okay, so we're still in place to make sure that we provide this service to our community residents. And we don't limit it. If you come from another borough, that is okay. If you come from another state, that is okay. If you come from another country, that is okay. We see a lot of that during our Harlem Week, mm-hmm. where people are coming out and that stop by our table to get the pharmaceuticals that we have to offer at no cost. So, you know, that's one of the things that do. We still have telephone counseling. Mm-hmm. We still have individual counseling. Now, like I said, normally if someone, if the public health educator is out, then I will, do the groups. I don't do them like I used to, but I love it. Still have the passion for it. Most people know that I do this not because I'm professionally trained to do it, but also because I lost my mother to lung cancer and emphysema. Mm. So this is a personal fight and a personal war that I have against tobacco. Wow. And, of course, I'm 20 years into not smoking, so it's been a very, very long time. For me, but I still have that same compassion. So every now and then, I make sure that I go in and talk to people. And some people still, they ask for me, and I will take the time out of my schedule to make sure I sit down. But, any way you want to do it as the patient, we meet a patient where they're at.
Yes.
That's why I say I don't just throw on, the modality. I think it's best for you. I have to sit down and have the crucial conversation. Mm-hmm, let's see where you're at, and then let me direct you based upon that. And together, we will win the war against tobacco.
I'm just curious to know, is there any particular reason why, and I don't know if you can answer this or not, that the other facilities or other hospitals don't invest in having support groups or investing in this cause like you are?
That's a good question. I'm not really sure. I know as far as Columbia and as far as St. Luke's, the reason why they send their patients to us is because of their funding.
Gotcha.
See, we're, Harlem Hospital Center, part of the Health and Hospital Corporation. We are committed to this tobacco, to getting people away from tobacco. We know the things that it costs in terms of health. And we know that the health costs that are associated with people using tobacco or smoking. So we're committed to treating the whole person. So anytime they come into our door, at every level, the person is asked, do you use tobacco and would you like help? We have people standing right by here now that you can go see right now. So they can walk in or they can call and make an appointment. Whatever they choose, we're here to serve them.
Excellent.
And that's one thing that we stay over the years. Harlem Hospital Center has had a tobacco program or a quit smoking program for many, many years. When I came aboard about 15 years ago, and Dr. Hurley, who was the medical director, and Dr. John Ford, who actually wrote the grant, years ago for that we stayed true to the cause. We wanted to make sure that, because our community, there was such a prevalence of smoking and the strokes and the heart attacks and the things that were coming into the ER or coming into our clinics. And then when you did the assessment and you looked at one major thing, they were smokers. Mm. They were tobacco users.
That's
and
what they
we
all
know
had in
that
common.
There is a correlation, for your circulation with diabetics. It is critical that diabetics stop smoking because that nicotine gets in your bloodstream, stops the circulation, and then we see toes coming off. Mm-hmm. We see fingers coming off.
And that's it. I'm glad you brought up that point because we're talking about a double whammy. With diabetes, this is a disease that high blood sugar causes damage to the blood vessels, especially the small blood vessels. And smoking added on top of that, especially if you develop high blood pressure as well, which smoking can also do as in addition to that. We're talking about a triple threat in which the circulation to some very important parts of your body, especially your kidneys, and we're talking about your heart, your brain, become choked off to the point of death to those organs.
Yes.
And it could happen slowly over time. Which would lead to serious disability later on, but it can also happen acutely, very suddenly, with a heart attack or a stroke, as Ms. Graham was saying, or even renal failure, kidney failure, where you have to be on dialysis for the rest of your life.
Yes.
So all of these things, it's just not worth it. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take our last break for the evening.
Already,
I know. Shoot. Time is flying.
Yes.
This is what happens when we have... such excellent guests.
I know, because I had so much just to say. And I'm like, already commercial.
as Ms. Graham said, this is a personal battle. So she's willing to you know, help you out and extend her heart to you to help you get through this. And if again, if you don't smoke, I know you know somebody that does, and they can use this information. So definitely spread the word. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll be right back after this break. Remember, the question is, what is the leading cause of disability in the United States? You have to post it to our page on Facebook. Type in the search box Health in Harlem, and you can post the answer there. And then also, you have to call into the studio. The number, I'm going to say it real slow for you all, 212-650-6903.
Show me the money.
Show me the money, right? 212-650-6903. You could be the winner of a $50 Macy's gift card if you could give us that answer. We'll be right back after this break. Stay with us.
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
Hi, I'm Vinny B of the Vinny B Showcase. Tune in every Thursday from 8 to 12 midnight for some solid cultural roots music and some sweet lovers rock. Also, informative interviews and giveaways. Right here on the Vinny B Showcase every Thursday, 8 to 12 midnight on WHCR 90.3 FM. Peace. WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
That is hard to cover, and it's the reason we mistreat each other, yeah.
Welcome back to Health in Harlem, ladies and gentlemen. I'm starting to get the froggy voice now, man.
Don't
it's
get
getting
that.
Late. No, let me stop. But you're listening to Health in Harlem. I am Maurice Selby.
And I am Sean Shivers.
And tonight we have Mrs. Eugenia Black Graham. She is the Assistant Director of Surgery Subspecialties at Harlem Hospital and also the Director of the Smoking Cessation Program at Harlem Hospital. And we're talking about just that, stopping smoking once and for all, winning the war, okay?
Against tobacco use as well.
Against
remember,
tobacco use.
Dipping,
yes.
Chewing, spitting.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
Now, can you get into that real quick? That what are the risks associated with that? What can that lead to? Because I think some people out there believe that that's a safer alternative to actually inhaling.
It's not.
Well, you know, that's why I said I don't want to leave this out because people lose tongues. Mm. Okay? They lose
oral
jaws,
cancer.
Cancer. Okay, and a lot of our baseball players, you know, they dip, spit tobacco, and it's very, very dangerous, you know, for them. I've had people in our program who lost a tongue because of them chewing tobacco. So, you know, again, you get oral cancers, you know, cancers of the gum, the jaw, have to get those things removed, and that's not fun at all, you know. So I want to make sure that I'm listening on audience knows that chewing tobacco that's not a safe alternate for tobacco use.
You know, I want to throw something out there, and you know, right now they are about to, in a lot of the states, is about to legalize marijuana use. You know, and the question I want to throw
ganja.
Out there, yes, and what I want to throw out there to you and off your answers tonight is that you have a lot of people in this community, a lot of people that I know and friends of mine who says that, you know, smoking marijuana is cleaner and better, and you see it on TV, than smoking cigarettes. So is that a myth? Is that a fact? Can you comment on that?
Well, when people come to me, because this is what happens a lot over the years, the doctor tells them they have to quit smoking. But the doctor failed to ask them what they were smoking. What exactly? So when they come and we sit down and we start that dialogue
That's
and things
funny.
Like that, and they say, well, you know, Miss Grandma, I smoke, you know, ganja, marijuana, then, or, you know, or I do crack cocaine. Then I say, we in the wrong room, and I refer them to the substance abuse program.
I got it.
Truth to power.
That is why. She said the doctor forgot to ask, are you smoking? No, but it's true though. But that's a whole other
that's
show right there.
That's a whole other show right
but
there.
We're talking so about some of the same risks though. I can tell you for sure. And okay. for those individuals that were, you know, with cocaine, for instance, some of the same heart attacks, the strokes, you know, damage to your
the
vasculature, your blood vessels.
Mm-hmm.
This is
brain
some
cells.
Of the same things.
Yeah.
These are all nasty habits. And I think the important thing to also get out there is that there's no judgment in all of this, ladies and gentlemen, especially when you go for help. Nobody's judging you. Nobody's trying to make you do something you don't want to do.
Absolutely.
Nobody is trying to change your life or make you live your life a certain way. People are genuinely there to help you stop this habit because it's dangerous. It's clearly dangerous. It's been documented over and over again, study after study. You know, you can see people on the street. I guarantee you within 5 minutes of leaving your house, you'll spot somebody that suffered from engaging in some of these habits and also smoking being the main one. You will see individuals with amputated legs.
That's right.
You'll see individuals with oxygen tanks maybe going to an appointment. They have chronic obstructive pulmonary disease,
yeah,
emphysema
COPD.
Due to cigarette smoking, people with lung cancer. We're talking about people with heart attacks. You know, they can only ambulate a few feet before they get short of breath.
Yes.
We're talking about serious disability. If it doesn't kill you, we're talking about serious
and then
disability.
Your quality of life. See, that's another thing mm-hmm. that people miss about your quality of life, because it might not kill you, as Marvin was saying, right away, but your quality of life. If you can't walk
yep.
5 steps,
yeah.
or you need a cane, or you have to have a walker, mm-hmm. like you said, an oxygen thing, that's your quality of life mm-hmm. right there. You don't want to take that away.
Mm-hmm.
So you need to get rid of the things that's causing mm-hmm. this thing. It's something that you can do.
Mm-hmm.
This is doable, and that's what I want to put out there to the audience.
Mm.
It is doable. I mean, now you're coming. I'm from a voice of experience, not just on the side of, you know, professionalism, but actually a person who actually smoked.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I actually smoked, so I know for a fact that you can do mm-hmm. it. And that's the space that we come from. No judgment. Okay, nothing like pushing you, making you do something, not rushing you to make, you know, a decision that you are not ready to make. That's why I love to have conversation first.
Yes.
And then when you are ready, mm-hmm. I will be there to help you get ready, and the rest of the staff will be there to help you get ready. And also, again, we talked about preparing you. Well, you're not, you know you want to quit, but there's some ambivalence there.
Mm-hmm.
Well, there is, like, we have the Zyban that you can still smoke and take medication.
Mm.
That won't be harmful for you. It'll start helping you lose your desire to want to smoke. And so there is so many things out here. That's why you must call me at 212-939.
Nice. I was going to ask you to get
it. I like that. Nice.
That's
once again, 212-939-8222. And it does not cost you anything except your time.
Got you. So the question I'm going to throw at you, and I know that everybody is different, but on average, from your experience, someone who is a hard smoker and they're at a point right now they do want to quit and stop, how long would you say the journey would take for them to start to control and get off the smoking?
Well, again, it would go back to your commitment level,
gotcha.
To the process. But if you're committed to it, anywhere between a month, 2 months, 3 months,
mm-hmm.
you know, we can begin to start tapering you down. If you decide that you want to use some type of pharmacological intervention. But once again, if you just want to do the cold turkey or behavior modification and substitute different things for that, you know, tobacco use,
mm-hmm.
it all depends on the individual.
Gotcha.
So there's something for everybody, essentially.
There is something for
everyone. For
everyone. Yes. There's a modality for everyone.
Awesome.
I want to throw out there. Also, I'm sorry.
Yes.
Just real
What's
quick
up,
again. This is something that I'm just thinking that I heard about last week. Hypnotism. Because I hear that. Is that effective?
For some patients, it is. I've heard both ends of it. Again, we've had throughout the years of, you know, being with the quit smoking program, I've had a lot of different patients, and some people have told me, like, prior to them coming mm-hmm. back, I mean, they relapsed, but they quit before, okay, by hypnotism.
Gotcha.
So it does work for some people.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay.
You know,
mm-hmm.
and I would like at some point just to be able to offer that as well at the Harlem Hospital Center, to give a person another vehicle
mm-hmm.
to help them quit tobacco use.
And just a quick question, are there other smoking cessation programs throughout New York City? Because not everybody has immediate access to Harlem. It would be easier for them if, you know, whatever borough they're in right now, yes, to what, where can they go for help?
Well, you know, all the HHC facilities have a quit smoking program. Oh, so you just need to know that in every borough, and we're in every borough.
So we're talking about Kings County Hospital, Bellevue, Lincoln,
Governor. But no one is as great as Harlem Hospitals.
Yep.
That's why I'm here tonight.
That's why I'm proud that I worked there.
You're a little biased in that statement.
I'm proud that I worked there.
But it's there for you. And if you go online, there's also interactive things online. There's a quit line as well. So there's a lot of different, vehicles or programs out here that can help you. But, of course, I want you to come to Harlem Hospital.
Yes, indeed.
I want you to.
So what would you say is the most important thing that our listening audience should take away from tonight's show?
You can do it.
Awesome.
Yeah,
I like that. Simple.
You can do it.
Yes, you can do it. Right?
Yeah, exactly. We have them, you know, for the quit smoking program.
Oh, you do?
Yeah, we have that, yes. That's and we have gotten different designs over the years, but that's our motto. You can do it.
And you still have the graduation for those individuals that go through the whole program.
Yes. We still have graduation, and we have a blast, too. We make sure we celebrate you. We celebrate you, and we allow your family to come to you. We give you a certificate. We give you some nice gifts. We have a DJ. We have a caterer. We have a whole ceremony.
Excellent.
Because this is a lifestyle change and something that you will be proud of. And so many people are proud. You heard Barbara calling tonight.
Yes.
That's right.
After
that's
so
right.
many years, you're she's right. still proud of it.
That's what's up.
Yes.
That says a lot.
Testimony right there.
And we definitely want to thank you very much, Ms. Graham. Thank you for not only tonight's show, but just for in the past your contributions.
Thank you.
And remember, you're always welcome.
Over the summer, she was outside the street with me.
Oh, yes.
Harlem Week.
I swear, I will never miss another Harlem Week in my life.
Please don't, brother, but I had a good time.
Because that is.
I would like to leave, if I can just say one statement I'd like to give to everyone.
Please.
Okay, and I would like to say this. Whenever your desire to quit becomes greater than your desire to use tobacco, you will be successful.
That's what's up.
Yes.
True story. So thank you very much. You are welcome. And I also want to thank my man Sean Shivers.
Yes,
I
want to
thank my boy Mo. And please make sure you tune in next week. It is our last show of the year, and it's going to be Health in Harlem Year in Review. Me, myself and my boy Mo, we are going to just talk about the great segments that we have throughout the
highlights.
Year.
That's
the highlights
great.
From January until right now. So please, we're going to give you a whole summary of Health in Harlem.
And set you up for the new year, pretty much.
Very much.
To carry on good habits and have good information. You'll be armed with good information.
So make sure you tune in next week.
Next year starting.
Please do.
Yes. So thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. We also want to thank you, the listening audience, for tuning into Health in Harlem. And also Valerie Wright. She is the producer.
That's my girl.
Health in Harlem.
Hey, Valerie.
This show is dedicated to the memory of Miss Gloria Thomas.
Yes.
Harlem.
Yes.
Take care of yourself.
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
This is the sound of someone correctly installing a car seat. And this is the sound of someone incorrectly installing a car seat. Correctly? Incorrectly. Hear the difference? No? That's because installing a car seat incorrectly is terribly easy. So much so, 75% of adults install them wrong. For simple instructions on how to get it right, visit buckleupforlife.org. Ah, perfectly executed. Brought to you by Cohen Children's Medical Center.
Domestic violence and abuse can happen to anyone, yet the problem is frequently ignored, excused, or denied. According to an article by the Huffington Post, 24 women per minute experience violence with their partner. According to the hotline.org, between 55 and 95% of women in 10 different countries, including the United States, who had been physically abused, had never contacted non-governmental organizations, shelters, or the police for help. Domestic violence has become a worldwide epidemic. If you are a victim of domestic violence or if you know someone who is being abused, you don't have to be afraid to tell. You can contact WARM. WARM stands for We All Really Matter and is located right here in Harlem. You can contact them at 347-346-6210 or visit their website at www.weallreallymatter.org. WARM will help you heal from and leave an abusive relationship. They will also help you transition from a shelter and rebuild your life. Again, that number is 347-346-6210.
It's not all.